Hello, malty medieval malt mates marching majestically. And I've trimmed that down, it was longer. Thank you to Daniel O'Brien for the provision of a malt mention for Ralfy Review 870 Extras. It's extras because I'm giving extra from the Bothy. And I've just finished a series, really, a short series, on exploring independent bottlings. Because Scotch whisky, more than most other liquor categories, rum, bourbon, tequila, has these hundreds of independent bottlers. Many of them are very, very small. Some are even just single proprietor shops, which occasionally buy a cask and bottle it for themselves. And some are really, really big, like Signatory and Gordon MacPhail, who have hundreds upon hundreds of different single cask and small batch malt whiskies, generally malt rather than blend, which they make available at different styles of presentation, occasionally at 40% chill filtered and caramel added, but usually a little bit higher because they're not official bottlings, and therefore to keep their market share, they've got to impress us a little bit more. So you're looking at starting about 43% in Europe, unchill filtered after 46%, 50% cask strength, unchill filtered natural colour. Many of the independent bottlers make a feature of this, they state it. They know that their bottles of whisky will be slightly cloudy in colour, but they also know that the people buying their bottles of whisky have matured enough in their own experience to know what that is all about. And the fact is that that slight haze in the whisky, particularly when they add water, and the fact that it's a higher strength, and it's a little bit nippier with alcohol, is something that just needs a drop of water and the important ingredient of thyme in the glass, very important part, just to soften up, mellow out and release the flavours, the sensations, the form and the personality of these single malts. And it gets even more interesting because there are quite a number of independent Scotch whisky bottlers in Scotland who also bottle rum. Cadenhead, for example, good example. And cognac, Armagnac. Bourbon, yes, you can even get bourbon bottled in Scotland. And single cask, very, very interesting. Few and far between, very few and far between. But it is known, you get corn whiskey, you get grain distillery whiskies like North British and Cameron Brigg. So there's quite a lot of variety that's available from independent bottlers. And they have their fans. And the fans, the successful fans, excuse me, a little bit of dust floating about the Bothy. Shouldn't be surprised at that. It's a dusty place. It's rustic and traditional. And anyway, I mustn't get distracted. And the independent bottlings, you know, when you go into their shops, it's just fascinating when you see all the uniform bottles on the shelf. They're all similar, but they've got completely different whiskies in them. And you know that when you buy a bottle, particularly single cask, unless you buy more than one bottle, you're unlikely to taste that particular signature ever again. And the thing is if it's a good whisky, you'll never forget it. And you'll look back in fondness and say, I remember in 2005, for example, that I got this Cadenhead Ardbeg, and it was glorious. Or I got this Murray McDavid Kulila and it was fantastic. That happens a lot. It's a sign of the maturation and the journey, the malt journey, where you've tasted a lot of the official bottlings, many of which are presented to the consumer market rather than the customer market. The passive consumer rather than the informed customer. But you need to start there, malt mates, to get your points of reference, to let your palate have time to adapt from the first taste of whiskey to that high strength independent bottling of something weird. Because if you jump straight in there after about a few months, you're going to be in for a shock. And then worse, you'll be tasting some weird independent bottling whiskey, thinking, oh dear, it must be me, I must be wrong, I must have inferior senses, etc, etc. And that's simply not the case. Yes, there's nothing wrong with your senses. Your senses are fine. Your smell of taste, sense of taste and sense of smell, they're both absolutely fine. But it's just that some of these independent bottlings can be too big a shock too early on if you're getting too excited about buying them. It's happened to me with a high strength Cadenhead bottling of, it was a Loman still from Craig's something or other. I forget it now. And it was in a kind of gold flaked tube. I think it was Blender's Choice or something, or Executive Choice. And when I tasted that whiskey, I didn't know what to make of it at all. After a few tastes, I had to put the cork on, put it in the shelf, and I didn't come back to it for another 2 years. At which point, I'd tasted that many other whiskies, I could come back and I had a much more experienced palate to get my bearings and enjoy the whiskey for what it is. Certainly, if you've got a disappointing bottling, do not, for goodness sake, pour it down the sink. Sure, you can get a second opinion from someone whose taste and smell you trust, but don't you think twice about sticking the cork back on the bottle, putting away in your shelf for a week, a month, a year, 2 years, 5 years, 10 years. Well, if you've got plenty of content in the bottle and just a small air gap, you don't have to worry about it going off. High strength spirits have got the longest lifespan of anything consumable to humans, period. It is perfectly feasible that a bottle of spirits could be opened after 1,000 years if kept in a vacuum and be drinkable. Just sharing. Someone's going to do it. I tell you what, you'd have to be careful about the bottle, because all bottle effect would be quite dramatic, would it not? Anyway, enough of my fantasies. I mean, it's another thing that I had thought was, with spacecraft now going into the solar system, it's only a matter of time before alcohol floating out in the universe can be harvested with massive dredging panels, because I've mentioned Sagittarius B2 in the past, which is a cloud of alcohol hovering in space that's about 3 light years long. It's massive. But the thing is, it's so light and floaty that even you'd have to drift in your spacecraft for several years before you could even get a glass full. I'll talk about that another time. Back to my extras here, independent bottlings. They can be weird, they can be fabulous, they can also be deeply, deeply, deeply disappointing. And you may find some, particularly where you've got to watch, is you get something that's been high age statement and you've paid the premium for that age statement, and it tastes much, much younger because the cask has been so inactive. But the bottler's been selling it in the age statement, not in the taste statement, on your tongue and on your nose. So you can feel shortchanged, you can feel you've been ripped off. And depending on your perspective, maybe you have. But this is why, with independent bottlers, if you've got any uncertainties, Hold off until you feel you're ready and then be guided by experienced people, whether you know them personally or you're networking with them online. People who are buying independent bottlings tend to be higher than average spenders. They're looking for something that's different and exotic. They know it's a place to look, particularly in terms of value for money from certain bottlers, like, for example, Signatory. Good example. And you will notice that each independent bottler has their own personality. You will notice, and this is where it really, really helps to do your homework, that some bottlers seem to have a good run of certain single malts and a bad run of other single malts. So you know when you're looking at an independent bottler that you've got a list, a tick list. If I buy these, I'm probably buying better malts than if I buy these different names. Beware of Macallan and Lagavulin from independent bottlings. Because of the name, they're heavily premiumized. But I've tasted a few Lagavulins and I've had a couple of Macallans from independent bottlers, and they were absolutely fine. They were certainly superior to the official bottlings. Way superior. Way, way superior. But equally goes the other way. I've had some Lagavulins which were just, and Talisker, oh, they were just dreadful. They genuinely were badly matured. See, it's not the spirit. With independent bottlers, it's never about the quality of the spirit that affects the final result, because the spirit's exactly the same spirit that's being used in official bottlings from exactly the same stills, and possibly even exactly the same run of the stills. It's always, only, and ever, primarily the quality of the cask that the independent bottler is using and the calibre of the storage of these casks. That's what it boils down to. I hope you've enjoyed my mini-series. It's been a pleasure to present it to you. Your malt mates, you see, so I know that myself, along with all the other influencers and presenters and commentators online, whether using traditional blogs or the video format, collectively provide a really good calibre of diverse opinions, experience and perspective, which is very, very rewarding. When you go online, by the time you've spent an evening over a glass of whiskey, seeing the content, deciding who you're going to watch more of and who you're going to watch less of and all the rest of it, you're going to be far, far more informed and ready for your next purchase than before the age of the internet. Because one reason people in the old days stuck to the same brand is because palates were completely institutionalized by budget and by choice. Totally institutionalized. And people would be swearing by Macallan because they wanted to reflect their socio-economic status and their professional status. And someone would be perfectly content with a bottle of Bells because they were going to put some ginger in it. Ginger beer, soda, lemonade, or just swig it straight from the bottle as they walked up the street. I can remember that happening plenty of times when I was a kid. My final comment is, it's far easier now than ever in history to be informed. And this creates a very interesting situation for the whisky industry, because through this massive sharing of information, which has never been possible before, so many people are now globally spending more money, knowing whisky more, being more informed. And how does the Scotch whisky industry adapt to that? At times, I think there's still mildly in shock and denial that it's even happening. But as I said recently, I think it was my last vlog, Ralfy Review 870, any new distillery now, and there's plenty new distilleries opening up, any new distillery that tries and bottles at 40% chill filtered and loads of E150 in the product, they're really gambling big time. Any particular small and medium-sized single malt distillery would be crazy to do that. It's either that or they're pitching their product to be in supermarket shelves, in travel retail, in style bistros, and in hotels. It's the way it is. It's fascinating to watch, and the whole thing's being accelerated by a pandemic lockdown because people are stuck indoors and people have time to know more. I'm Ralfy. Thank you for watching. Pop back again for Ralfy Review 871, which will be a blended whiskey. Yeah, I occasionally still buy them, believe it or not. I know, controversial, but there we go. Now you know. I hope you've enjoyed this. If you like to subscribe, you're welcome to do so. Bang the bell, click likey, all the nice things, and good luck to you. See you soon.